What's up, YouTube? It's Josh Hewitt from Top Form Fitness. Time to do it with Hewitt once again. And today I'm here with a good friend of mine, Scott Grisewood from Shockwave Therapy.
How are you doing, Josh?
Good. Thanks for joining me, Scott. Scott and I go way back to when I was competing in strongman athletics back in my past life, and he helped a lot of the athletes out at the events. And I know you've evolved your career into a lot of different fields. What have you been up to over the last few years?
Well, Josh, after the strongman, I got into doing some shockwave therapy and been working on research with regards to treatment protocols for shockwave therapy and performance enhancement. Been working a little bit with things like quantitative movement screens and using surface electromyography, force plates, laser gait analysis systems, things like that to quantitatively understand human movement and how we can best change it.
Awesome. One thing I wanted to talk to you about today is extension, the importance of extension in our flexion-dominated society, and how that relates to everything from hormones to posture to overall health, etc. What have you been looking at as far as extension?
Well, it's one of my favorite subjects because it's not really talked about a whole lot. There's a lot of cutting edge research going on right now, and I just wanted to say, like, a lot of the things I'm going to talk about today are from a colleague of mine down in Texas. His name is David Lemke, and Dave has studied human movement with surface EMG for 30 some years, and he's mapped the extensor circuit, if you will, and we have a much better understanding of how it works and how we can manipulate change to that circuit now that it's been mapped. And I'll go through some data and case studies with you and show you everything I know about extension today.
All right, where should we start? You want to look at posture first?
Yeah, let's just talk about basic posture and what that looks like in general in today's society. So basically, you know, it all starts from little kids and putting, you know, tots in chairs. Right, all the way through school and secondary school and so forth. Everything that we're doing in society today is essentially a flexion-dominant motor pattern. Everything from driving to eating to sitting to a lot of work, computer and that kind of stuff. And for years, we've always tried to study biomechanics and how to change that, and we haven't had a lot of great luck doing it. Because as we find out, it's not just about biomechanics or the positions that we're in biomechanically, it's also about emotions and how emotions affect posture, and also what we can do to change that. We have great studies coming out of Harvard that talk about posture and hormones, which reflect on emotions. So when we put the two systems together, we have a better understanding of how to manipulate it and keep better postures and keep better health through our hormonal balance.
That's one thing I'm particularly really interested in learning in now that I'm in my 40s is how it relates to hormonal health.
Okay.
If we just show an overview, What sort of studies are out there that talk about extension related to hormones?
Okay, so great study out of Harvard by a lady by the name of Amy Cuddy. She does a TED Talk, 24 million views on it. Check it out, it's awesome. But the gist of the study basically is about posture. And she's identified weak body postures, things that look like this, you know, like so, this kind of thing. Again, flexion and internal rotation types of postures, these types of things. And she identified strong body postures, similar to what you're standing in now, almost like the Superman stance, almost like so, right? The other ones are sitting back in a chair, but again, we're extended and opened up. So the boardroom chair with the feet up and the elbows back like so, or standing at the boardroom table like so. These are all extension dominant postures. It's absolutely amazing that this puts a link between mechanical movement and the production of our master hormones. So in this study, as it turns out, it says 2 minutes of a strong body posture, as identified by Amy, and this is one of the Superman stance. After 2 minutes of holding that stance, our testosterone goes up 25%, and our cortisol goes down 20%.
Okay, that's pretty significant.
That's a big change in our master hormones, and this study implicates that there's a mechanical way to do it. As opposed to a pharmaceutical way, as we all know.
Yeah, we can control it just through changing the way we stand, our posture.
Absolutely. And I invite everybody to check Amy's study out. We'll provide the link for that. And
I'll put that down below as well.
For sure. And check out her YouTube TED Talk as well. Amy, in her studies, she's a sociologist. She talks about how people can make a better impression at a job interview.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? I look at her work and I go, wow, this is all extensor-driven work. And here's a mechanical way to manipulate our master hormones. We better get on this for the people that are in the gym life.
Yeah,
and as soon as people understand how that autonomic nervous system works and how we can manipulate it with movement, they can start incorporating these aspects into their training at their gym and their overall health.
Absolutely. What would be a quick example of a way an average gym rat or one of my viewers might be able to take advantage of this, knowing that posture relates to stress hormones versus testosterone, say around a workout?
Okay, so if we take the study at face value and the fact that when we go into an extension dominant posture, mm-hmm. we can expect to get these types of results as Amy did in her study, that indicates to me that in between reps, before you start training, after you're done training, mechanically we can give ourselves a little shot of testosterone.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, we're decreasing our cortisol. So when we look at cortisol and testosterone in terms of the autonomic nervous system, cortisol is catabolic.
Right.
Testosterone is anabolic.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we obviously want an anabolic scenario for our gym rat friends.
Mm-hmm.
And any time that I get a chance to, whether it's in the shower or in between sets, I go into and hold that extension dominant posture.
Mm-hmm.
Just as a mechanical way to help me get through that workout and make sure I'm flooding my system with anabolic hormone.
So as part of your warm-up and during preset?
Absolutely.
And even post-workout, maybe in the shower yourself?
Absolutely. In the shower, I like to do the contrast showers too, just to help flush out.
Hot, cold, alternate.
Yeah, just to flush out the metabolites of the workout. And while you're there, heck, for 2 minutes, if you stand like Superman, nobody you're going to see anyway. It's no
right.
big deal.
Exactly. So what you suggested so far is that we can affect our hormones, specifically testosterone and cortisol, by just changing our posture. And does that happen through our nervous system? Like, is our nervous system based on our posture affecting hormones health?
It goes back to the autonomic nervous system. We have the parasympathetic side and we have rest and digest, and the sympathetic side is fight or flight. Some people call it the inhibitory nervous system and the excitatory nervous system, same sort of thing. But basically, they're opposites, okay? We have dilation of pupils on the sympathetic side and constriction of pupils on the other. And it goes down the list. The gist of it is that one side is the opposite of other. One side mm-hmm. controls the balance of the other. And what they don't talk about in here with regards to the muscular system is the fact that the autonomic nervous system controls muscles as well. It controls us in posture. Like yourself right now, we're having a conversation about the autonomic nervous system, and you're not paying attention to the muscles that are keeping you upright.
Right.
So whatever your posture is right now is an accurate representation of the relationship between your flexors mm-hmm. and your extensors,
mm-hmm.
okay? And so when we get into the sympathetic side of the nervous system, and this is where the emotions come into the whole postural game, and it's not just biomechanics, is that a sympathetic event is a warning. It's our primitive warning system, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And whenever there's danger or warning, we have to protect ourselves.
Or even a perception of danger.
Exactly, exactly. And that can be danger or it could be something that upsets you. So for example, if somebody you cared for passed away suddenly, you don't present with a posture like yourself, you present like so.
Yeah.
And that's another constant drive that drives our flexor motor pattern to dominate our extensor motor pattern.
Mm-hmm.
So that keeps us in these positions, same motor patterns that we drive in, that we eat in, that we computer in.
Sit at a desk.
All that kind of stuff.
We have stress driving us here. We have our work, our daily activities are driving us into that flexion posture, and there's actually very little that's going on naturally, unconsciously, bringing us into that extension, in our society at least.
That's right. So to understand flexion and extension, it's got to do with front and back. It's generally flexion and internal rotation that is the drift that we go into, okay? Mm-hmm. It's just how far into that twist are we going? Because not too many people, as you know, present with true neutral posture.
Right.
Okay? So because posture is an autonomic event, we need to train it autonomically. And so the problem with our gym training is that when we've tried to address posture in the past, we go to what we call back work.
Right, back okay. day.
Back
right.
day.
Which is typically like rows, pull downs, maybe a deadlift.
Absolutely.
All of this sort of stuff.
Yeah. So scapular retraction, scapular depression, mm-hmm. all those good things that, sure, we need to do those, but we're missing something, and we're missing the opposite motor pattern of what we spend most of our day in. Mm-hmm. So the opposite of flexion and internal rotation is extension and external rotation. So we have to strengthen, we have to flex those muscles just like a bicep if we want to make it stronger. Mm-hmm. So tell me the last time your hand was in this position where the shoulders extended, the elbows extended, the wrist is extended, and the fingers are open and externally rotated as far as they'll go.
Right.
No. Okay? Not very often. So that's like having a bicep that we don't fully go into full flexion with.
Right.
Okay? So when it comes to that nervous system, we have this constant drive hormonally, cortisol, any kind of stress puts us into this position, including grip. Mm-hmm. So like I spoke about just a minute ago, was extension is open fingers and external rotation. The opposite is flexion and grip. So we'll talk about grip.
Grip is a big part of this.
Well, lots of implications about grip. We'll talk about that. But just to get back to that nervous system, just for one more second, we really should be revising this and adding extensors. If the parasympathetic side fires our extensor circuit, mm-hmm. the sympathetic side fires our flexion circuit. Flexion internal rotation, mm-hmm. this is extension external rotation. So let me give you an example of how that happens without us thinking about it.
Okay.
Okay? So recently the Cubs just beat the Indians, and if you were an Indians fan, that was bad luck for you.
Yeah.
Okay? Now I think back I think back to when Toronto won the World Series and Joe Carter hit the home run. Mm-hmm. And when I look at that footage, they pan the crowd, and you see people, they're grasping like this, and they're doing this kind of stuff, and they're, can't wait for him to get over, okay? So as soon as, this is the stressful position, this is stress, is he gonna do it?
Yeah.
Okay, then he hits it over the wall, and all of a sudden, without thinking about it, we go into extension.
Right.
Okay, and that happens without us thinking about it. Mm-hmm. So how then do we train posture to happen without us thinking about it?
Right, if you want to make it an autonomic function.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So how we do that goes back to Mr. Lemke and the motor pattern that he developed, and the exercise kit that he developed is designed especially to work that circuit in a circuit.
Okay.
Not individually, but in a circuit. And what happens is, when you start the motor pattern of extension and external rotation, it's a very, very voluntary event. There's just like a kata, mm-hmm. right? There's lots of little things that you have to pay attention to in your breathing and position and so forth. And what happens is, you take a while to get the hang of how to do that.
It's like greasing the groove.
Like greasing the groove. So once you get the hang of doing that, and you go around your little checklist of all the things that you have to do, you go, okay, I got this. Mm-hmm. And the minute you say that I got this, mm-hmm. that's when your consciousness goes to what you're gonna have for dinner tonight, or what you're gonna do on the weekend tonight. Mm-hmm. But we got something going on here. We've got motor firing that's mm-hmm. happening without us thinking about it, because we just flipped the extensor circuit on autopilot.
It's like walking. You don't have to think about walking.
Exactly. Right. So we really do need to understand, or have a better understanding of what exactly is voluntary and what is autonomic.
And this alternating extension movement pattern will train you into that extension till it becomes an autonomic movement. And this will help to increase testosterone, reduce
absolutely
cortisol levels.
Absolutely. So the trick is to first master the movement pattern in sequence, okay, to get it to the point where you don't have to think about cross extension and all the positioning that you're doing. It's almost like you wouldn't have to think about hitting the deck if a bomb went off behind you without thinking you'd be down in this. So the same thing, we need to impress on the central nervous system a way for these muscles to fire without thinking about it, okay? Because back to posture, it is an autonomic event. When we stand in front of people, we don't think unless somebody cues us about our posture. And that's why cueing posture doesn't work.
Right.
Because it's only as good until we forget about it.
Right.
We need it to work on that autonomic level, and we need to access the brain or train the brain to have that group of muscles fire without us thinking about it. So we just have to set it up that way, teach it how to do it, and as long as we do on a regular basis, a few minutes in the morning, a few minutes at night, we're constantly keeping that extensor circuit turned on and working.
What's the big, you mentioned grip, and I know that's a big thing.
Yes.
Because of that, the strong grip involved with rows, pull downs, even deadlifts, pulling movements, which can help bring us into an extension of some.
Sure.
But on the other hand, the grip is strongly putting us into flexion. How does grip relate to our hormones or that autonomic nervous system?
Okay, so grip goes back to part of the flexion circuit, if you will. It's sympathetic response.
When you squeeze.
Is when you squeeze down. As a matter of fact, your heart rate goes up the harder you squeeze your hand.
Mm-hmm.
And that, again, is an autonomic response.
Okay.
Okay. It's an excitatory response. And so that means that all the gym training that we're doing, if we're grasping, we are essentially producing cortisol.
Mm-hmm.
Based on what these studies are telling us, when that closes down and our heart rate goes up, we're eliciting a sympathetic response. So if there's a way to pick up that weight without closing the hand down, then we have much more electricity available to go through the extensor circuit. So back to fight or flight, if you think about back in the day when we were dragging clubs and sticks around and we needed to fight or flight, the grip is absolutely necessary to be able to protect ourselves and climb or get away and so forth, right? Or even
guard,
you know, guard things like that. So as part of that sympathetic response, we know that it increases cortisol. So if we can do the lift with a grip-free cuff, we can drive more electricity through the extensor circuit. So it's like the more you close the hand down, the less available electricity is available to go through the extensor muscles. So when you think about a deadlift, that could come in pretty handy. And so as you know, when people do the reps with the deadlift, they tend not to squeeze as hard because they don't have to.
Right.
And what happens when you put the reps on and you do the deadlift? Boom, 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 you start to go up. You get to go to a higher level.
Yeah. So it's not to say not to train grip. Like you said, there is an application for having a strong flexion grip.
Absolutely.
But it's in our society and in the way we train, we've neglected to a large extent extension.
Right.
So if we want to target muscles into extension while we're training our pulling movements, there may be a benefit to taking grip out of the equation to some extent.
Yeah. So there's a study here that Lemke did, and I'll show you, from North Idaho University Physical Therapy. And this is a case study on surface EMG and what happens to the target muscles when we are either gripping or using a grip-free cuff. So he did the test for the product of the grip-free cuff, and he showed the outputs of the other muscles with and without grip, and it is significant.
So these are the flexilate straps?
Yeah, these are
grip-free training straps.
These are the grip-free cuffs. They actually won product of the year in 2006, bodybuilding.com.
I have a pair myself. I love them. I use them on my pulling days, on my back days.
But they go on the back of the hand like so, wide end covering the back, and we just use resistance like that. So it allows us to extend the wrist backwards and fully ignite the extensors of the forearm. So we talked about balance. When I work with arm wrestlers, that's a crowd that is hugely flexion dominant. And as we know, we're best served by balance on both sides of a joint. And yet the problem is when we go to work the back of the forearm, then the trouble starts because we typically close our finger around a dumbbell and do a reverse curl.
Right.
So the problem is that we're not fully contracting the extensor group, because when we do, it brings the wrist backwards and opens our fingers. Mm-hmm. So a reverse curl like this, I get less activity out of on an EMG sensor, 3 pound extension, than I do a empty, full proper extension
right.
of that forearm. Mm-hmm. So the arm wrestlers are now starting to do open hand extension to bring balance back the wrist and the elbow joint.
Yeah, and literally training the antagonist.
Exactly. Right. And we can't do that the second you close the hand down around
a
dumbbell.
Holding a weight and extending doesn't actually allow you to extend all of the extensors involved with hand
extension.
That's
right. The muscle does not fully contract in that position. It'd be like only doing bicep curls just down in this range, like so.
And this is a simple way people can incorporate that into their gym workouts.
Absolutely.
It does feel a little different starting to use these in your first few workouts, and you have to get used to that feeling of not actually gripping or just lightly touching. But you will feel the target muscle groups
for
significantly.
Sure. It's more difficult to do a bicep curl, and it'll feel more difficult.
Yeah.
But the thing is it's getting more activation. When you do a bicep curl with an open hand, or a tricep pushdown with an open hand, mm-hmm. you may not be pushing the same amount of weight, but you're getting more muscle recruitment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if that can be demonstrated on an EMG, as you said.
Right.
And that's what I keep getting into with training in general. Unless you're doing powerlifting and it matters how much weight you're moving, if you're training for physique transformation and you want to target those muscle groups, make them grow or develop them, even just getting them stronger, just don't focus as much on the weight as you are on muscle activation. So that comes into the tempo you train at, how strongly you contract your mind-muscle connection, and then we talked about here.
That's kind of like training with your brain instead of your ego, Josh.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, ego lifting. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Right.
Well, we've all been there, though.
For sure. That's part of being young.
So this is really cool stuff, and it's nice to see the practical applications we can do in the gym setting and whatnot. You talked about how our posture and how we carry ourselves day-to-day, flexion versus extension, affects hormones.
Mm-hmm.
But does that work vice versa as well? Or talk to us a little bit about more hormones, because I know with biofeedback, you put yourself into a certain position, it can make you feel a certain way. But then when we feel that way, it also tends to put us into that position. They work vice versa.
Exactly. So there the emotions come into play and how it affects our posture again. And mm-hmm. and so when we're in a sympathetic state, we're down, we're depressed. It's funny, all societal anecdotes are all extensor-driven anecdotes. So when we see somebody who's down, what do we tell them? Stand tall,
chin up,
shoulders
buddy.
Back,
yeah.
Chin up,
yeah.
grow a spine, whatever
yeah,
it is,
yeah.
But they're all extensor-driven anecdotes,
right.
Okay? And that's really important. I mean, we've been around here for several thousand years. We have had some observation capabilities, and that's one of them that anecdotal evidence, I think, is spot on in this particular case.
Mm-hmm. And even Tony Robbins and a lot of his NLP and his motivational speaking talks about change your body posture to change your emotions, right?
Absolutely. You know, we're on to something. We're just putting the pieces together with these great studies coming out of Harvard, for example, and with Lemke studies, and it's painting a big picture of how we can control our master hormones, we can control our posture, and what that amounts to from a symmetry standpoint is a subject we hadn't quite touched on yet. And when we search for symmetry, we're looking for balance. So balance isn't just being able to stand on one foot with your eyes closed, although that's an attribute we all need to be able to do. When we're talking about balance, we look at muscle firing, and when we use equipment like surface EMG, we pull reports that look like this, and you can see that this left glute does not fire the same as the right glute, nor do the hamstrings fire equally. So this is a dysfunctional cross-firing pattern. And the issue is that when the extensor circuit is weak, because of all the postural things that we're doing and our emotions and so forth, when they're weak, it allows the hip flexors to dominate that side of the pelvis and roll it forward. Usually it's bilateral with one side more so than the other. We are not symmetrical left to right. When we look at our flexor and extensor relationship and we start to strengthen that extensor circuit, as a circuit in the glutes and external rotators, we find that we start to fire more symmetrically. So our front-back relationship
affects left to right.
Okay. Exactly.
All right, that's very interesting.
So once we get extensor circuit in order and up to speed, then we fire symmetrically left to right. It's like in that sweet spot.
So that saves us also a lot of time. If we're thinking of training, instead of training left, right side, more reps on the weaker side, vice versa, taking care of this extension can help to take care of that.
That's
right. Right balance as well. And that has definitely a carryover for performance, but also for aesthetics, if you're training in physique or whatnot as well, firing muscle groups that we want to grow proportionally.
Right. So when I'm talking about flexor circuit with regards to extensor circuit, and we talk about symmetry, everybody makes fun of the beach body, okay?
Right.
The guy with all arms and chicken legs, okay? And if we find that funny,
yeah,
we have to pay attention to the front-back relationship.
Scott, that's great. That's a lot of information as well. If people wanted to go in a little more in depth or find out more about it, what's the best way to find you online or in person if they want to learn more?
Well, they can go to my Facebook page, Shockwave Therapy Center.
Okay.
Or they can email me at info@shockwavetherapy.ca.
Okay, great. Thanks again, man, for all this.
Yeah.
This is great information. I encourage you to check out the links down below to learn more. And thanks again for your time, Scott.
Awesome. Appreciate it.
Yeah. All right. Until next time, stay strong.